So I want to welcome everybody to our October Women's Program webinar. We are so excited to have you back again for another wonderful session. We have an amazing mentor. She's a seasoned mentor here at ACP. She's in her second mentorship. Amy Parsons is just a lovely person to be connected to. She's got so much knowledge, and she's going to talk to you about the top five mistakes that small business owners make, which I think is something that's really important to our veteran and military spouse community. So I'm going to introduce Amy in just one moment. Before I get to that, just some quick housekeeping. Please keep yourself muted unless you're asking questions later on during the Q&A session. Please feel free to utilize the chat feature, connect with other people here, other veterans and male spouses who are in here in the presentation live. You know, feel free to drop your LinkedIn, ask any questions that you have for Amy or for myself regarding ACP. We're definitely excited to have you here and to see you all engage with us. So thank you again for joining. So I would love to introduce Amy. As I said, Amy is a seasoned mentor here with us, and she's just a wealth of knowledge. So Amy has decades of experience in sales and sales management, working for companies ranging from startup organizations to Fortune 500 companies. She has developed multi-million dollar revenue streams in business-to-business sales environments and has been trained in many sales systems. She has successfully managed local, regional, and national teams of salespeople to achieve these high-reaching objectives. For the past 16 years, Amy continued to hone her skills through starting up and managing two successful corporations, a brick-and-mortar dog daycare, boarding and training facility, and an online dog training business. Amy is a certified business coach working with the Alternative Board, helping small to medium-sized business owners achieve their goals. She has also used this unique skill set to help veterans by volunteering as a coach through ACP over the last 2 years. So without further ado, I would like to turn it over to Amy. Amy, thank you so much for being here. We are so excited to hear all that you have to offer today.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm really excited to talk to everyone. The veteran community is one of my passions. It's something that I believe in wholeheartedly, and thank you all for your service. It's something that is, I think unless you're in it, you don't understand the actual sacrifice that's involved. And I have several family members that are either still in or retired members of the service. So thank you all for all that you have done and the support that you give to your families and the community at large. So I like to look at this when I talk to small business minded people as please learn from my mistakes, because it's something that we all tend to learn lessons either the easy way or the hard way. I personally subscribe to let's do everything the hardest way possible. So I feel that if I can help people avoid some of the common mistakes or things that I have done, then that's a win for everybody. So that's what hopefully we'll be able to cover some things today that are common topics that come up and things that hopefully you can learn from. And like I said, avoid some of the mistakes that I've made. So. Are we ready to go into the presentation? Okay, great. Let me just share my screen here so everyone can see it. Okay, so the first mistake that I find that small business owners or people interested in going into small business make is that they do not apply the proper value of your own time. So I think that when we are the business owner and we are the product, really, you know, it doesn't matter if you're doing a service-based business or an actual tangible product that you're creating, the reality is that you are the business. And in the beginning, it's generally just you, right? Most businesses don't start out with, you know, a full staff. It's you doing everything. So, and when we do that, it's very easy for us to discount our own time that we put into it. And one of the things that is a common topic when I'm coaching somebody is the value of your own time and how do you place that value appropriately so that you're not hurting yourself in the long run. So you need to really look at what your costs are for your end product or service. And a big part of that is going to be your time. So if you are service driven, then obviously it's 100% of your time that is the product or the end result. And if you're a product-based business, you will have some costs to create the product, but you're also, your time is involved in that. So it's really important that you take a close look at how you assess your input to that. So you need to start tracking the amount of time that you spend on these things. And it's something that not a lot of businesses do. I'm just trying to get my spacer button here to work. Okay, so you have to know what your value is to it in order to accurately price your product or service. Because what a lot of people will do is they say, okay, well, I'm gonna make, I don't know, let's use the example of wreaths. Okay, let's say I wanna do a business where I make my own wreaths. So then you have the cost of the products that go into that. Okay, so if you want to sell your wreath, let's say that they're going for, you know, $25 on the market. And by the time you get all of your products together, your cost is $15 to make that. So if you look from a percentage standpoint, that's not a horrible percentage difference between $15 and $25. But then if you calculate in how much time does it take you to make that wreath? Because if you do not accurately reflect your time, you will never be able to expand or grow your business. Because, you know, most people don't set out doing this thinking, you know, for the rest of my life, I want to be chained to a little craft table and make wreaths. And that's it. From morning till night, I'm going to be making wreaths. And that's it. You want to be able to expand your business. And if you don't know what the value of your time is, and you don't calculate that into your costs, then how can you hire somebody? And now you've got to put their direct cost into your product. So it makes it very challenging to calculate that. Then you also want to look at, you know, not only that from a pricing standpoint, but how, if you hire somebody to help, how good are they doing? Okay, so if you know it takes you a half an hour to complete a task, now, granted, you have to realize that you're going to be a expert at that task by that point. So it's going to take you less time than somebody new coming in. But you need to have a goal in mind. So if you know it takes you a half hour to do something, then a new employee, if you're starting out, maybe 40 minutes should be what should take them to complete the same task. But if you don't know how long it takes you and your new employee is taking an hour and a half to do it, you don't know whether, you know, it's hard to gauge whether or not that's a good job or not. And how do you coach somebody accordingly? So it's really important in the beginning that you start looking at the amount of time that you spend doing these things and how that impacts your product. And then that also helps you then being able to accurately gauge the success of your business. Because if you don't calculate in your time, then when it comes to growing, or if you get to the point where you need funding or anything like that from banks, these are the kind of questions they're going to ask. And if you don't have answers for those questions, you're not going to be able to take your business to the next level. So I did a quick example here, just to give you an idea of a common pitfall. So let's say that you're a consultant and you charge $100 an hour for your services. And I tried to keep the numbers pretty easy here. So if your hourly rate is $100 and you say to yourself, okay, I want to go into business for myself, how many hours a week could I work? Well, the normal person would say, okay, well, if it's a 40-hour work week, if I was able to do consulting for 20 of those hours, half of the time, then that would be a reasonable expectation. Okay, so half your time is spent doing your actual billable work, and then the rest of the time you're dedicating it towards billing and customer service and all of that. So all of the business side of things. So that sounds reasonable. And then that would mean that you could average around $2,000 a week in revenue, which is $104,000 a year. So that doesn't sound so bad. You know, it sounds reasonable as you're going through your expectations. But then we have to look at the reality check of that. So if you have a hourly rate, how much time are you spending in advance prepping for that appointment? So let's say you spend 30 minutes in advance prepping for each appointment. And then if you're actually doing live customers, you have to add in commute time. So your commute time would come into it. So for this, I said, let's say we do a half hour travel time each way. So that means for your 1 hour consulting, you are now doing an hour of travel time and then a half hour of prep time. So your new time allotment is 2.5 hours per client. So that means that your weekly schedule just dramatically changed. So you are not going to be able to fit as many clients in. If you were still looking at doing 20 clients a week, now you're up to 50 hours of your time dedicated just to your appointments. And if you look at each customer is 2.5 hours of your time, that means you're not making $100 an hour anymore. You're making $40 an hour. So it dramatically can impact how you price your product and the end result of what you're getting. And what most people do is when they're not calculating in their own time, they fall into the trap of now you're so swamped because you have so much to do to fulfill those 20, 1 hour appointments. And now all the time to manage your business is gone. So it's a vicious cycle that you can very easily get yourself in if you do not respect that. Oh, sorry, my screen just... Can you still see me? There we go. My mouse is doing all kinds of funny things on my Mac this morning. So let me just skip ahead here. If anyone's trying to do an online business, this is your reality too. Technical gremlins. Okay, so the next, if anyone has any questions on that part of it, please put it in the chat room and we can address them at the end. But so the next thing that we look at is a common mistake is when you should hire your first employee or your next employee. Like if you're getting to the point where you're feeling too busy, how should you handle that? And when do you pull the trigger? And, if you're like most small businesses, a 40-hour work week doesn't exist. You end up working 50 plus hours. Entrepreneurs tend to be very dedicated, almost obsessive people when it comes to their businesses. So we put our all into it. And it makes you, when you get to that point where you're crazy busy and now you need help, that's like, kind of making the decision behind the eight ball. So this is actually, one of the most common topics in a business owner's group is employees and the stress of employees and hiring, coaching, firing, expectations, all of that is a very stressful part of owning a business. So when you're working crazy and you're running around like a chicken with your head cut off, where do you find the time to do the things like create a job description and go through applicants that apply? And when you're going through applicants, it's like trying to find a needle in a haystack, because you will get, if you post anything online, you might find one qualified candidate for every 40 applicants. So you're really doing a needle in a haystack. Looking through those, so it takes time. Then you have to schedule and conduct interviews. And then once you make a decision, now where are you going to find the time to train somebody? Now all of a sudden you have all of your work to do, plus you've got to train somebody on doing your work. And that is a very, it's a challenging situation, and it's something that's very common for businesses to fall into the trap. So what I like to talk about is working in your business versus on your business. And that's how you need to look at the hiring question. So most small business owners spend the majority of their time working in the business because you are the business. So you're selling to clients, you're fulfilling orders, you're handling customer service. That's all working in the business. Working on the business is where you're dealing now, you're trying to get new business, marketing, sales, social media, running those, running your web page and your internet presence, bookkeeping and accounting, lawyers, all the compliance issues, all the, you know, some of that is really the tedious stuff that most small business owners, you know, we want to put our hat on and do what we like to do and do what we're good at. And now all of a sudden we're asked to put on 15 different hats. So that's the stuff that is important to not push aside. So when you are looking to hire, you always want to look at it earlier versus later. So if you're getting to the point where you're starting to get stressed or busy and you're wondering whether or not you should bring on a virtual assistant or an actual, you know, employee that's going to help you with the day-to-day stuff, you need to take the plunge before you think you're ready. Because if you wait to the right time, it's never going to be the right time. And the longer you wait, the busier you're going to get, which makes everything harder. So you have to make sure that you're dedicating the time to train the employee so that they know how to support your efforts and not, you know, add to your never-ending list of things that you have to do. One of the most common things that I hear business owners say is, it's just faster for me to do it myself rather than train somebody else to do it. And that's a very dangerous road to go down. So you have to make sure that you dedicate the time to set aside for the training so that someone else can help you with those tasks. And again, going back to the time involved with what it should take you to do the task versus how much time it should take an employee to do it versus you doing it, you know, and getting them as close as possible to your time frames so that you're gaining ground instead of losing ground. And when you do hire, you always have to give clear expectations. One of the things I always tell people is, if you're having a challenge with an employee, you have to really ask yourself, have I clearly stated my expectations? Because we tend to fall into the trap of thinking that our employees have the same value system as we do, especially as it relates to our business. Our business is our baby, and no one else is going to care for your baby the way you do. And that's the reality of it. So giving your employees the right expectations up front of what you expect and how you expect it done is crucial. And then the other part that's very crucial is inspecting what you expect. So when they have completed the task, instead of looking at their end result and saying, oh, geez, this is not really what I wanted, I would have done it differently, and then you just take the time to go and do it yourself. You need to take the time to teach your employee what it is that you actually wanted. Make sure they understand, make sure that they can complete the task. So the next time, you do not have to go through that same, it's like a hamster wheel, you know, getting stuck on it all the time. And then the other thing, last thing that I always recommend is when you hire somebody, make it clear upon hiring them that there's a probationary period. It's a good out for you. So let's say you set up as a 30-day probation period, you could do a 60-day, you could 45-day, whatever time frame you want. And just make sure that they understand that during that time, you know, they're subject to termination at any point if it's not working out. And it really helps the business owner feel like not every decision is, you know, like the sun isn't going to rise and set on this employee if you made the wrong decision up front. And you don't drag it out too long, which is the other mistake people make, is the warm body syndrome, where somebody's there and doing at least some of the work, even though they're not doing what you would really like them to be able to do, at least it's some help, so you keep them on. But in the long run, that doesn't help you. Now, you do want to check with your state rules for that. I know that I live in Pennsylvania, and it's a hire at will state, which a lot of employers call it fire at will state, but you know, that is something that's important to know as well with your state regulations for hiring and firing, if there's anything specific you need to do. Okay, so the next thing that is a common mistake is the overall customer experience and as it relates to consistency. And there's a book that I always recommend that my new business owners read, and that's called The E-Myth, and E stands for entrepreneurial. So it's the entrepreneurial myth, and Michael Gerber writes it. And one of the common examples he gives in the book, and it's a really quick read, it's an easy read, it's not boring. It's got a lot of good stories in it, and it really hits home if you're thinking about or have started a business. But McDonald's is one of the things he uses as an example as far as consistency. And it doesn't matter, you know, McDonald's is McDonald's. You know, I mean, you don't have to love it, even though that's what their ad says. But you know exactly what to expect if you go to McDonald's. You know, if you want, you know, you don't even have to think about it. You know exactly what that Big Mac is going to be, or you know exactly what that hamburger is going to be. And that's going to be no matter where you go in the world. And that's one of their claims to fame, is that consistency. So the example, where this comes into a small business owner, one of the examples he gives in the book is a hair salon who started out, I believe it was like a men's hair salon. And when they came in for a haircut, there was a receptionist there who greeted them and seated them and asked them if they wanted a beer. And, you know, really kind of catered to them when they came in, got a good haircut. It wasn't, you know, great, but it was good. But the overall experience was really good. So they went back, the customer went back. And the second time he went back, the receptionist or the assistant was still there, but she didn't seat him this time. And it took a few minutes before she acknowledged that he was there. And then she came over, she was stocking shelves and came over and asked them if he wanted something to drink halfway through his appointment. And you know, the haircut was still okay. So, but it wasn't the same. It was not the same experience. So then the third time he went, the girl was still there, and this time never asked if he wanted anything. She was busy the whole time helping customers and stocking shelves and things like that. And they'd never asked him if he wanted anything to drink. And it was just such a different experience, even though the haircut was consistent through all three visits. It was so different from the first that the customer never went back. And it's important to point that out because it's a psychological thing. And if you start to look at when you do your shopping, and you buy products, you know, if you go to, a good analogy is to go to a grocery store, like in this area, they have Trader Joe's. And Trader Joe's is known for off brands. You know, you go there and let's say you want mayonnaise and you're a Hellman's person, you know, and that's what you get. Well, when you go there, you're not going to recognize any of the names of the mayonnaise that they have. So what do you buy? You know, that it's an uncomfortable feeling, and that's because of consistency. You know what to expect versus trying something new for the first time. And so it's really important for small business owners to understand that. And you have to set yourself up in the beginning, because in the beginning, you're always going to have more time to dedicate to each individual client than you will once you get busier and you have multiple clients pulling you in different directions. So try and put some thought into it of what the experience is that you want your client to have. And you need to strive to make it consistent and predictable so that they come back and continue to come back. Otherwise, like I said, chances are, even though the second experience or the third experience was still fine, just the fact that it was different can turn people off and make them not buy again. So it's a really important thing to understand. And one of the things that happens to all business owners is we get busy, we start working crazy hours, our clients are, you know, it goes from wanting to help people to, they're nagging me again, or they're calling me again. And you get burned out very easily. And when you get burned out, the first thing to suffer is the customer's experience. So setting your expectations properly in the beginning and making sure it's realistic for you to be able to implement these things is key. And then you want to the dreaded processes and procedures conversation. Once you have the process narrowed down so that the customer experience is where you want it, Now you need to try and document that so that when you do hire somebody, they can step in and know exactly how to do exactly what you've already been doing for clients. And that's a very hard thing to do. Most small business owners do not do processes and procedures. We're flying by the seat of our pants, and we bring an employee in and we're like, just do this and I'll do that, and things are crazy. So you want to make sure that while you have the time and you're putting your thought into this process that you want your client to have, start writing down what it is you do and how you do it. Even if you just make notes, even if you just do one step for each client, document one step of the process for this appointment, next appointment, document the next step. Within a few weeks or a few months, you should have all of your processes outlined in writing. And that's very easy then to turn into a processes and procedures document that you can use for an employee if you have to hire. Or even if you never intended on hiring an employee, you have a business and something happens to you. You get sick, you're in the hospital, and one of your family members needs to step in. It's a great way to, you have that safety net to say, okay, well, here's the document of what I do and how I do it, so that someone can step in and help you during that time. So let's talk about marketing. Okay, marketing is also a hot topic. And marketing is something that is kind of like it's very nebulous. It's like this thing that exists out there. And a lot of business owners are intimidated by it, or you feel like if you don't have enough knowledge, you're doing it wrong. You're not really, are you doing it intentionally? Is your success happening on accident? So marketing is something that can definitely cause a lot of stress and anxiety for business owners, because it's going to tell you, where is your next customer coming from? So I have tried absolutely every kind of marketing there is. Okay, there is not a type of marketing that I have not tried in my businesses. And so I'm going to break down for you what I feel is required and what is not required, okay? Because once you go into business, you're going to start getting sales calls from everybody regarding marketing. Or you'll get the direct messages online or emails. So in today's day and age, you have to have a website, okay? You have to have an internet presence. If you think about your own buying habits, if you're thinking about doing business with somebody and you know nothing about them, the first thing you're going to do is do a Google search and see what comes up. Or you want to go to their website and see what it is. And if it's a janky looking website that's, like put together, you could tell that their 12-year-old kid did it, that says a lot about your business. So it's important that you have a nice website, and it's not expensive to do nowadays. I mean, you can go to your hosting, like GoDaddy hosting. You can do a website on there that's fairly easy to maneuver and do it yourself for a nominal amount of money. So it's not hard to do them nowadays, but it is extremely important for you to have that online presence. With my business, my brick and mortar business, the last probably 5 years, I would say that we average about 60% of our new business is found online. They did a Google search and they found us. So the internet presence is very important. And then the next highest source of new customers is word of mouth. So you make your existing customers happy, they tell their friends and family, and you're getting referrals. So word of mouth is a very important thing to cultivate. So once you get that new customer in, make sure they're happy. Make sure they're pleased. Go out of your way to make sure they're happy. We started a process at my brick and mortar where whenever we got a new customer in, we would send them in the mail a little dog toy, because I own a dog business. So we would send them a little package addressed to the dog, and it was gift wrapped, and it was a little toy with a little handwritten note to the dog thanking them for coming to our facility. And people post it all over the internet, and it's, all over Facebook, and they message us and thank us and send us pictures of their dogs with their new toy. And it really helped us with our word of mouth, because just that little thing. It cost us, I think it's like, it's under $10 that it cost us per client to do it. And it it went a long way. So even just a handwritten note nowadays is something that nobody does anymore. And that's something that can mean a lot to somebody just to say, thank you for doing business with me. So make sure you cultivate those existing clients and maximize your word of mouth. And then you have to make sure that it's easy for people to contact you. One of the things that I ran into with my brick and mortar business was that, you know, we're busy and we're never by the phone. We're never by the front desk. We're in with dogs. We're doing training. We're helping customers. We're, you know, if I have a customer standing in front of me, one of my personal pet peeves is when you go to a business and somebody's helping you at the counter and the phone rings and then they answer the phone and now they're ignoring you and talking to the person on the phone. That's a pet peeve of mine. So I wanted to make sure that we weren't doing that. But then at the same time, people calling in, if they're not talking to somebody live and nobody's answering that phone, you're losing potential business. So the ease of contacting you needs to be there. So what we ended up doing was doing a virtual receptionist, not an answering service, but a virtual receptionist. And they're out there where they actually, they do the script according to what you give them. They can even schedule appointments for you. They portray themselves as an employee. So you would never know that it's an answering service. It's a great concept. I can't tell you how many clients would come in and go, oh, I talked to Sally this morning. I didn't know you hired somebody new. Can I meet her? And it's like, oh, well, Sally's actually our virtual receptionist. So it makes them feel good to have somebody answer the phone and get their questions answered right away. So ease of contacting you. Online options nowadays, texting options, messaging, direct messaging, social media options with that. Those are all easy ways that people can get a hold of you, but you need to respond ASAP to those. If you think about it, well, I don't know how, you know, I know in from back in my day, when I started in the business world, cell phones weren't what they are nowadays. And you could leave a message for somebody at their office and somebody was actually writing a handwritten message and giving it to somebody. And you could expect to hear back from that person in like 48 hours. Nowadays, if you can't get a hold of somebody right away, it's frustrating. Are they ignoring me? Did they ignore my call? Why aren't they texting me back? I see they read the text. Why aren't they texting me back? So that's all stuff that we are used to nowadays. So your clients are going to have that same expectation. If they reach out to you, you need to be able to get back to them right away. So as you're setting up your ways of contacting you, make sure that your expectations are clear. We will get back to you within 24 hours. And, you know, or we'll get back to you within 12 hours, but make sure it's doable for you so that you're not failing potential customers before they even come on board. And we already talked about this a little bit, but social media is very important nowadays. People will go to Google first, and then they go to social media platforms to look for you. And these are the basic rules of thumb. If you're doing a business to consumer structure, okay, so you're selling directly to the end user, and your average client or your ideal client is over 40, Facebook is your go-to. If your average client is under 40, Instagram is your go-to. If you're doing business-to-business sales, then it's LinkedIn. And you don't need to spend, you don't need to do all of them. You need to just hone in and get really good at the one that's your sweet spot based on your ideal client. So you don't waste your time trying to be everything to everybody because it doesn't work. So target your clients based on those age ranges, and that will really give you, allow you to become more prolific in that one individual social media platform. So formats that you don't need. Any kind of print advertising, okay? And you'll get hit up by everybody. The magazines, even newspapers are still contacting for advertising, believe it or not. You know, you get the companies that do the placemats at the diner, or they do the grocery carts at the grocery stores. They always are contacting people. Or the coupons, you know, the coupon envelopes that you get in the mail. And new businesses, you don't need brochures. When's the last time you brought a brochure home? Someone gave you a brochure and you brought it home and you actually went and looked at it again. Probably never, right? We just recycle them. So don't waste your time and energy and money on printing brochures. They really aren't relevant anymore. And there's our fun with the coupons. A quick note on coupons too. Coupons are something that I have found, I just don't do them at all anymore. We did them in the beginning, but what you'll find is you need to really research what your ideal client is. And if your ideal client, if your product, if your sweet spot is on the lowest price, end of story, then maybe coupons are good for you. But most businesses don't go into that position and say, you know what, I do what I do and I'm really good at it, but I'm going to be the cheapest out there. It's not really a marketing tool that works really well, and it's not necessarily sustainable. But that's the kind of people you get with coupons. You don't get repeat customers with coupons. You get someone who comes in with a coupon, and then they're not coming back again unless they see another coupon. And my favorite example of that is I get Kohl's coupons in the mail. I think Kohl's is a nationwide chain, but it's a clothing chain, and they always have coupons, and they'll send you either a 15, 20, or 30% off coupon. Well, if I look at that coupon, if it's not 30%, I'm not going. So, it's a habit that we get into with coupons. So you're setting a dangerous precedent with that sort of thing for your business. So I would be wary of coupons. Radio ads and TV ads are very expensive. And the problem is that you can't really, you can't drill down into your target base like you can with social media ads nowadays. Radio ads, it's a geographic area, so are TV ads. But if you're targeting, women with kids that are teenagers, and that's your target market, in social media, you can specifically target those individuals. TV and radio, you're paying for everybody to hear your ads, not just those women. You're paying for everybody, men, children, older women, younger people. It doesn't matter. You're paying for it all. So it's very hard to justify the cost of those things, especially in the beginning. And billboards is the same thing. Same rules apply. Everybody's seeing it. So they're more expensive, and it's something that you don't necessarily need. Okay. And yes, I have done all of those, even TV ads. next piece of advice that I like to give, I guess this is our fifth one, is to ask for advice. Okay. So yes, you're excited to have a new business and do your own thing and be your own boss, but you do not need to recreate the wheel at every single turn. You are struggling with the same thing that other business owners are struggling with, and they don't need to be in the same industry as you, okay? I mean, same industry is potential competitors. So it's better to go to people that are not in the same industry. My brick and mortar has been in business since 2006. I opened just in time to hit 2008 with the economy taking a big dip. So that was a fun time. But since 2008, I had joined a business owners group that I paid for every month to belong to. I still belong to it. And that's actually the group that I coach for now. But I credit my business surviving and thriving to that group, because what it was once a month, I would get together with a group of peers, other business owners that were in non-competitive industries, and we could bring any topic to discussion. And it's basically people that are in the same boat as you, and gives you a really healthy outlet for that. Our significant others, some of them are really supportive of our efforts, some of them are not. But either way, they do not understand, unless they own their own business, what it's like to be an entrepreneur. So their sympathy can only go so far, and the empathy really can't be there at all. But when you talk to other people who are in the exact same boat as you, or people who have already been there, done that, and you're getting advice from them, it means so much more. And it also allows you to get remotivated, because one of the things that you is very constant with small businesses is it is a roller coaster of emotions from one day to the next, if not one hour to the next, of this is awesome, it's the best thing ever, to oh my God, how am I going to survive the next week, oh my God, this is wonderful. You know, it's a constant roller coaster. So it really is helpful to reach out and have somebody that helps to remotivate you, because they're giving you fresh new ideas that you didn't even think of. And that's one of the things that I always felt being with people that were from different industries. When you're in a particular industry, there's certain ways you do things, and that's just the way you do them. And when you talk to somebody who gives you ideas from their perspective, from their industry, all of a sudden, whole new worlds open up. I'll give you a quick example with that. So the biggest part of my brick and mortar business is dog daycare. And so traditional dog daycare plans are you pay by the day, or you can prepay for a certain number of days and then use those days as you go, and you get a discount for prepaying for the days. Now, that's traditional. That's what everybody does. My group helped me think outside the box, because cash flow is an issue when you have a small business. You know, are you going to have enough cash in the bank to pay your rent when the rent bill comes in, or to make payroll? Cash flow is always a concern. So we came up with the idea of doing a monthly membership idea instead of doing prepaid packages or pay by the day. So the first of every month, everybody gets charged for whatever package they chose for that month. And all of our cash flow issues were resolved. And it's not that difficult of a concept, because people understand that's what they do with childcare. That's what they do at gyms. You know, so it's not a difficult concept for people to understand, but it was a huge help, an enormous difference between my business struggling from month to month and then my business going to being very profitable. So that's what I mean by thinking outside of your box and your industry's standards. So the group that I belong to is called the Alternative Board, and they call it TAB. And that's, you know, that's what they do. The other option for advice is called SCORE. And that stands for the Service Corps of Retired Engineers. And that's a national organization. And it's free. And that is something that you can contact your local SCORE chapter and get advice from retired executives. So the only thing I found is that a lot of the executives with SCORE worked for banks. So it's a lot of, like, you know, people that were upper management at banks or large corporations, and they specialize in. So if you need help with your finances, you can talk to somebody in that department, or human resources, they have somebody for that. So it's a little bit more corporate-like, but it's free advice. And one of the things that's very valuable that they have is on their website, they have a service where you can actually create a business plan through their website, and it's free. And you just answer the questions. They'll take you through a question and answer session. And based on your answers, they then plug it in and give you printed out text of a complete business plan. And they do it for both the written portion of it and the financial portion of it. So I used both of those things when I started out. And I know a lot of other people who have used them as well, and it's very helpful. So those are the top five things that I wanted to talk with you about today. And I know we have some questions. If we're ready to go to that section.
Absolutely. I know that there were a couple that did come into the chat feature while you were going through that presentation, if you want to pull it up and take a look. And we do have some pre-submitted ones as well. So let me pull up both of those for you, Amy.
My mouse is disappearing on me again. There we go. Okay. So do we want to start with the sent in questions, you tell me, where do we want
to
start?
No, I mean, if you're comfortable going to the chat, let's answer some of the ones that came in live, if you would like.
Okay. So the first question is, how would you price the prep time and travel time, at the same $100 rate or something different? Okay. So that's a great question. Because the answer is, what is the value of your time? Okay. And what you will find is, in the beginning, you want to value your time less. So you want to say, okay, well, it's $100 for when I'm actually working with somebody, but it's only $50 when I'm commuting or something like that. But the reality is that that time could be spent with somebody else at $100. So you really should base your value on a flat rate, hourly rate, and stick with that regardless of what tasks you're doing. And the other important part about that is, as you grow and you realize that you're spending time on those menial tasks, that, you know, more administrative type tasks that you might enjoy doing because you can check it off your list really quickly. But could you pay someone less than $100 an hour to do it? Most likely the answer is yes. So that's a good gauge on when you should actually, how much time are you spending on those types of tasks? And it's much less expensive for you to hire somebody and pay them $15 or $20 an hour to do that task as opposed to your $100. And that should free up your time then too, to do more of those, the actual consulting time. Okay, so I think I answered this question as we went through, but my thoughts on Groupon and other discount coupon sites. I think I got my point across with that, but you can tell me if you think that I need to touch on that anymore, but I think that coupons are dangerous. It's such a dangerous precedent, and that's not repeat customers. You're not going to get those customers back in unless there's another coupon. That's been my experience and what I've seen from a lot of other businesses that, you know, like salons and things like that do Groupons. I've seen that a lot with those types of businesses too. What are other resource tools or sites to use for just starting out? Okay, accounting, budgeting tools, business plans, marketing outlines. So I mentioned the score. They have a lot of very good free resources. The other thing you can check is your local colleges. So there's several local colleges, like I know in this area, Kutztown University, which you can access from anywhere in the country. It's KUTZ Town University. They have a small business portal where they also have things that are free that you can go on and look at, and different tools that you can use. When it comes to accounting, accounting is something, and that's one of the questions that came in that was sent in advance, dealt with that. It asked, what is the best way to establish a small business in terms of LLC or S Corp? And the answer to that is, it's really an accounting question, and you should talk to an accountant about it, because it affects your personal taxes, how you structure your business. So you need to make sure that you're taking full advantage from a tax perspective. Not that we all don't want to give more money to the federal government, but you know, maximizing your tax dollar is important to a small business. So the more money we keep in our pocket, the better. So you want to make sure you talk to a professional about that. And the other piece that I'll mention on that is that all accountants are not created equal. It took me 10 years and going through 4 different accounting firms before I found one that I liked. And that's because, as a small business, what we need help with is not our taxes. I mean, we need to get our taxes done, but that's not what we need help with. We need help with understanding our financials, understanding our financial reports. How do you read a profit and loss statement? How do you manage your cash flow and understand a cash flow statement? How do you understand your balance sheet? These are the things that we need help as small businesses. And not a lot of accountants offer that type of thing. So you definitely want to shop around, find someone that specializes in small businesses and someone who actually sits down with you quarterly and goes through this stuff with you so that you're pre-planning and understand where you are and where you need to be. And then the business owners groups are also very good with that because they spend a lot of time educating business owners on those pieces of how to be a business owner. What are you doing to overcome the challenges related to COVID? Okay, that's a great question. So COVID has obviously, reinvented our businesses. If you weren't working from home and online already, everybody is now. And even for brick and mortar businesses, the online portion of it has become so much more important. So, I think that every business is unique as it relates to the challenges that they experience. But I think the important thing is making sure that you're communicating to your clients to give them peace of mind that if they do have to come and physically see you or come into your facility, that you're allowing them the peace of mind that you're taking the necessary precautions. But then you also, that's a great time to start thinking outside of your box. You know, how can you do business in a way that you never thought that you would have to maybe by doing online? And it's a really, it's kind of a fun new challenge for some business owners to try and look at, how can I do this? I transitioned to, with my brick and mortar business, I started a separate online business just dedicated to dog behavioral issues because that's usually just training people, not the actual dog. And that's been a steep learning curve because obviously the technology involved can be challenging, but it's been a lot of fun too. And I get to talk to people all over the country now where before I was just dealing with people locally. So it's been exciting, but I think you really have to first and foremost, make sure your customers are comfortable. And then how can you think outside of your box and come up with new ways to service them? Whether it's, if you're a store where they have to come and see you, maybe it's something where you develop a template, or, you understand what their wants are. I'm thinking like a clothing store or something like that, where maybe you're now mailing them things to try on at home and then have a return policy or something like that, as opposed to having them, they have to come in to see you. So just, we've all got to get creative with that.
I'm going to turn to some of the pre-submitted, and we have a couple more minutes, so I want to see if we can capture some of these. So one of the ones we received is, my husband is getting ready to retire from the Marine Corps. We have 1 year almost exactly. I've always wanted to have my own small business, but it's in the crafting world, so I know there are many challenges being seen in that market. Am I crazy to want to start this now, and is there ever a good time to start a small business?
Yeah, that's a great question. So first of all, crafting is a great hobby. And one of the common themes for business owners is turning their hobby into a business. But that can in itself create some challenges. So you have to think about it from the standpoint of when you're crafting and you're doing it for fun or for yourself, you're doing it when you want to do it. And if it's a business, now you have to do it because someone placed an order. There's a big mental difference in that. Doing it because you want to versus doing it because you have to. A lot of people end up then resenting their hobby when it becomes an actual job. So you want to think about that and kind of do some soul searching to see if what camp you would fall into with that. And crafting is also one of those areas where valuing your own time is very important. So, if you're selling something based on the cost of your goods that it takes you to make it, but you're not calculating in your time, it might not even be feasible. You probably, if you're like most small businesses, you're working below minimum wage at that point for your own time. So you need to make sure you calculate in your time. And I would say do the financial piece of it first to see if it makes sense. See if it makes sense for you. Can you, if you calculate in the value of your own time, if you were to do this and get paid an hourly wage for it, calculate that value into your cost of your end product. And can you make any money then? That's a very good place to start to kind of wonder whether or not it makes sense. But if it does make sense, I would highly recommend you check out Etsy. I know a lot of crafters have had a lot of success with Etsy, and there's some really good programs out there that you can, you know, if you want to pay for a how-to on how to sell on Etsy, you know, how to market your product, how to get higher in the search results of the website, all of that. There's some good services out there that can teach you that, but Etsy's a great online venue for that, that gives you a much larger potential customer base than going to the local craft fair and trying to sell there. And in what inevitably happens, my mom was a big crafter and she did craft fairs for years. What inevitably happens is you're trying to guess what people are going to want. So you make 10 of these and 20 of these, and the 10 of these sold out before, you know, you were an hour in. And you don't have any more, and nobody wanted the ones that you made the most of. So it's kind of so Etsy gives you the ability to make them as you go, as the orders come in, which is a nice alternative.
Oh, awesome. Great advice. So another one we have, which it looks like from another spouse. So how do you juggle it all? A spouse being deployed, caring for small children without childcare, growing a business, doing day-to-day business activities, running the house, maintaining relationships with family and friends.
Yes. All very overwhelming when you think about it. So there was a study that they just released recently that that should make you feel better. And the study said that the average person going to the office and working for 8 hours is actually only productive for 2.5 of those hours. So if you think about it from that standpoint, it's not the amount of time that you dedicate to something, it's the quality of the time that you spend. So what I would recommend is that you start, if you feel like you've got 100 balls in the air and you're worried about dropping them because it's impossible to juggle 100 balls, but the first thing you want to look at is where is your optimal time? Everyone's different. What is your best time of the day? Is your best time of the day, are you a morning person? And you know, you're that's the exact opposite of me, by the way. So my daughter's a morning person and she drives me crazy. But if you're one of those people that likes to get up at 5 a.m. every day and your best time is in the morning, then that's when you should spend your time working on your business. If you're an afternoon person or you're an evening person, then that's the time that you should dedicate. That's your most creative time. Dedicate 2 to 3 hours a day. Don't stress about 8. Just dedicate 2 to 3 hours and make sure that when you're doing your work, that you're allocating accordingly. So one of the things that that I always recommend to my coaching clients is that you should have every day a list of three things. Your first category should be your must-dos, the things that you have to do today. You have to get them done. Your next list is the things that that need to be done, but aren't as important. Okay. It doesn't, you know, it could wait till tomorrow, and tomorrow it might make it to the A list from the B list, but it's not necessarily an A list today. And then the C is your busy work. The stuff that if you're honest with yourself, most people gravitate towards busy work when we're procrastinating A and B, but we want to feel like we did something. So we go to the C list, and we will start to tick things off of our, you know, we got to check things off of our list. So we feel better that we did something, but the reality is it's not as productive as we had knocked off a few things on our A list. So if you look at it from that standpoint, and when you're maximizing your time in that block of time that you dedicate to you or your business, make sure that you're hitting off at least a couple of those things on the A list. And then the other stuff can wait until you have more time. But if you think of it that way, if you could spend 2.5 hours a day being as productive as somebody who's at the office for 8 or 9 hours a day, that's pretty impressive. It makes you, you know, you could put on like a superhero cape at that point, and it leaves you so much more time to deal with the homeschooling and cleaning the house and all of that fun stuff that we still have to get done.
Well, thank you so very much, Amy. That brings us to the close of our hour. This was excellent. I think that I took away a lot of information that I really didn't know about, and I hope that everybody else in here did as well. I think that, it looks like we had some really great engagement and a lot of people who were on this call. So I'm sure you really impacted some more lives today. If anybody has any other questions, please feel free to email us and let us know. We're here to support you through this. Like Amy was just sharing, I mean, we've all got a lot of things on our plate that we're trying to juggle. And so hopefully this was helpful as you're either building your small business or growing out your small business that you've already started. I just, again, want to thank you, Amy, so much for your time as a mentor in our program, but also coming on and sharing this information. Any last minute wrap-ups that you wanted to share?
No, thank you for having me. I hope it was valuable to you all. And I, again, want to just thank everybody for their service, because it's an amazing thing that you guys do.
Absolutely. And I want to mirror that. Thank you all for your service. Thank you for tuning in today. We appreciate you all. And please stay safe out there.